students, good day. I am one of your teachers for this week, and later on, you will meet the others that will give you very important lessons. And I hope that you will watch the entire video, because after, we will be having an assessment. So for this week, our topic will revolve on Brunner's constructivist theory. By this, we will learn on how this theory important is and how this can help in our learning. So to finally begin our class, I will be giving the floor to Ms. Medico, as she is assigned as the first teacher who will impart her knowledge or share her knowledge about the said topic. Ms. Medico, take the floor.
Brunner's constructivist theory. According to this theory, learning is an active process. Learners construct new ideas based upon their past or current knowledge or prior experiences. Jerome Brunner introduces the three stages of representation of knowledge, which is inactive representation, iconic representation, and symbolic representation. The first stage of representation of knowledge, which is inactive representation. Children at this stage learn through actions on physical objects, and the results or outcomes of these actions. Learners learn through actions, or they use actions to encode or store information. For example, muscle memory like shaking a rattle. Infants will shake a rattle expecting an accustomed sound. Another example is learning to ride a bicycle, an adult sewing a shirt. And now, let's proceed to the second stage of representation of knowledge, which is iconic representation. Children at this stage learn through using models and pictures. Learners can now use mental images to stand for certain objects or events. Learners use image base, such as models, pictures, illustrations, or diagrams to encode or store information. For example, a child memorizing what the dog is by looking at the images of the dog. So through looking at the images of the dog, the child gained or learned knowledge about it, about the characteristics or physical traits of a dog. And now, let's proceed to the last stage or third stage of representation of knowledge, which is symbolic representation. Learners at this stage has an ability to think abstract terms. They use symbol systems to encode or store information. Learners use symbol systems such as mathematical notations or symbols, music symbol, words or languages, and many more. For example, the word dog is a symbolic representation for a single class of animal. Another example is a flag that evokes a particular emotions or feelings about a nation or country, or a flag that represents a country. Jerome Brunner advised that teachers should bring together concrete, pictorial, and symbolic activities to facilitate learning.
What is spiral curriculum? So when we say spiral curriculum, it is a concept widely attributed to Jerome Brunner. Spiral curriculum, it is refers to a curriculum design in which a key concepts are presented repeatedly throughout the curriculum, but with deepening layers of complexity or in different applications. Such treatment allows the earlier introduction of concepts traditionally reserved for later, more specialized courses in the curriculum after students have mastered some fundamental principles that are often very theoretical and likely to discourage students who are eager to apply the concepts they are learning to real-world application. Brunner introduced that teaching should always lead to boosting cognitive development. He stated that students will not understand the concept if the teachers use plan to teach using the teacher's level of understanding. The task of the teachers in this curriculum is that first, translate information to be learned into a format which appropriate to the learner's current state of understanding. Second, the curriculum should be organized in a spiral manner so that the students will continually build upon what they have already learned. Thus, the teachers must revisit the curriculum by teaching the same content but in different ways, depending on students' developmental levels. That's why certain topics are presented in grade schools in a manner which appropriate for grade schoolers, as well as the same topic is tackled in a high school but much deeper level. In this area of learning, Brouwer introduced the spiral learning, which helps the students to get clearer understanding and more effective learning. Wherein we learn in a spiral form, which the lesson is given to us step-by-step process in accordance to the level of our understandings. Example of spiral curriculum in the aspects of mathematics. Spiral curriculum is probably most easily seen in mathematics because most topics in math build up each with increasing complexity. For examples, in first grade and the beginning of second grade, students learn simple addition and subtraction facts.
Now, let's discuss the legal basis in using the spiral curriculum. The use of spiral curriculum in teaching learning process was based on the Section 5 of Republic Act No. 10533, stated that the curriculum shall use the spiral progression approach to ensure mastery of knowledge and skills after each step. In K-12, a spiral progression approach applied in math, this would mean that teachers teach algebra, geometry, statistics, and trigonometry concepts from kinder to grade 10. In science class, biology, chemistry, and physics concepts are taught from grade 3 to grade 10. And this approach was contrast to the disciplinal approach of math and science in teaching 2002 Basic Education Curriculum, or BEC. Wherein algebra is taught in first and second year, geometry in third year, statistics and probability and trigonometry in fourth year. And in sciences, integrated science is taught in first year, biology in second year, chemistry in third year, and physics in fourth year. As you observe, there is a difference between the two approach, between the spiral progression and the disciplinary approach in teaching. In math, in spiral progression approach, the concepts are taught from kinder to grade 10, while in disciplinary approach, algebra is taught in first year and second year, geometry in third year, and statistics and probability and trigonometry in fourth year. So in spiral progression approach, the concepts are revisited again and again as you go up the grades, in contrast with the methods that involve learning something and then moving on, possibly never to engage with it again, which is the spiral didadisciplinal approach. And now let's go to the three characteristics of the spiral curriculum. First, we have revisit topic at regular intervals. So, students revisit the same topic multiple times to reinforce learning. Second, complexity of the topic increases. The complexity of the subject matter increases as the child's cognitive ability develops with age. As we may notice that the lessons in our first grade are the same lesson in our second grade, but in more complex. Third, new learning connection to old learning. Students' familiarity with the subject matter or ideas enables them to grasp the more difficult concepts in a deeper way. For example, in mathematics, your teacher might start with simple fractions, then move to the complex fractions, and finally ask you to add and subtract fractions. Another example, children know first the alphabet and into words, next into spelling, and then into grammar, then learn to construct sentences, and then finally learn to make a paragraphs. So this is how spiral progression approach applied in teaching learning process. A spiral curriculum tries to expose a wide variety of ideas over and over instead of focusing for relatively long periods of time on a specific narrow topics. Hope you learned something. What is spiral curriculum?
Discovery learning. Discovery learning is a theory that refers to acquiring knowledge for oneself, introduced by Jerome Bruner. It encourages learners to build upon their experiences and knowledge to use their intuition, imagination, and creativity, and to seek for new information to discover facts. Bruner believed that learning does not equal to absorbing what was said or read, but actively searching for solutions or answers. There are five principles of discovery learning method. Principle 1. Problem solving. Teachers should guide and motivate learners to search for information by interfacing existing and newly acquired information and simplifying knowledge. Principle 2. Learner management. Teachers should allow participants to work either alone or with others and to learn at their own pace. Principle 3. Integrating and connecting. Teachers should teach learners how to associate prior knowledge with new and encourage them to connect to the real world. Principle 4. Information analysis and interpretation. Discovery learning is process-oriented and not content-oriented, and is based on the assumption that learning is not a mere set of facts. Principle 5. Failure and feedback. Learning doesn't only happen when we find the right answer. It also happens through failure. Discovery learning does not focus on finding the right end result, but the new things we discover in the process. There are four major aspects of theory of instruction. First, predisposition to learn. Bruner introduced the idea of readiness of learning. He believed that subject could be taught at any stage of development that fits the child's cognitive abilities, and that learning and problem solving arose out of exploration. Second, structure of knowledge. This feature refers to the ways in which a body of knowledge can be structured so that it can be the most readily grasped by learner. It includes the following. Understanding the fundamental structure of a subject makes it more comprehensible. Moreover, Bruner viewed categorization as a fundamental process in the structuring of knowledge. Second, to generate knowledge which is transmittable to other contexts. Best suited are the fundamental principles or patterns.
The third aspect is effective sequencing. Effective sequencing said that no one sequencing will fit every learner. Sequencing or lack of it can make learning more easier or more difficult. So the fourth and the last aspect is reinforcement. According to this aspect, rewards and punishments should be selected appropriately. According to Bruner, by doing this, it will give inspiration and motivation to the students or learners in doing something.
Now, let's tackle and discuss categorization. The word categorization is somewhat very familiar to us. When we say categorization, this can refer to the act or process by which things, objects, events, people, or experiences are grouped into classes. Usually, things that share the same features, attributes, or characteristics are placed on the same category. For Jerome Bruner's constructivist theory, he gave much attention to categorization of information in the construction of internal cognitive maps. Cognitive maps is sometimes called mental map. When we say cognitive map, it is a mental picture or image that help us navigate unfamiliar territory, give directions, and help us learn or recall information. Cognitive mapping is a powerful strategy for organizing, communicating, and retaining knowledge. Going back to categorization, Bruner believed that perception, conceptualization, learning, decision-making, and making inferences all involve categorization. Based upon the idea of categorization, Bruner's theory states that to perceive is to categorize, to conceptualize is to categorize, to learn is to form categories, and to make decisions is to categorize. He asserted that people interpret the world in terms of similarities and differences which are detected among objects and events. Objects that viewed as similar are placed in the same category.
Let's proceed to the kinds of categories based on Bruner's cognitive learning process. First is identity categories. Refer to a category where being identified as such based on the attributes or features. This can be applicable to subjects or any objects. Examples, groups are categories of motorcycles, bicycles, cars, buses, airplanes, helicopters, group of green apples, group of red apples, babies, old and green bananas. Second one is equivalent categories. It is effective when rules or certain criteria are applied in determining or identifying a particular category. It is analyzed or categorized like through emotional reactions, functional criteria based on their related functions, or by formal criteria like involving sciences such. An apple is still an apple, and whether it is ripe or red, green, dried, or even it is sliced, it is a food and it is a member of botanical classification group. It is called on its whole or original or general name, whether it is an annex or so even if described holistically. Example of equivalent categories are car, truck, and van. They are classified as motor vehicles. Apples, oranges, and grapes. They are classified as fruits. Shoes, sandals, slippers are classified as footwears. Helicopter, jet planes, airplanes, they are known as aircraft. So now let's proceed to the last and third category. It is coding systems. These are categories that serve to recognize sensory input. On the basis of categorization through coding system, it is particularly based on the similarities and differences of the subjects or objects. The features and attributes are referred to coding. Through that, coding system is indeed crucial because it helps identify what category that thing should be considered to. The awareness or idea to organize things from each other, the awareness on categorizing objects or subjects, that even simple wisdom or knowledge can help to recognizing things. Through that, people can predict objects or subjects on the basis where they belong to. Example, a child would know it is a flower before knowing it is a sunflower. A child would know that it is a flower before knowing it is a bougainvillea. A child would know that it is a tree before knowing it is a narrow tree. A child would know that it is a dog before knowing it is a chihuahua dog. A child would know that it is a cell phone before knowing it is an iPhone or Samsung. And the last one, a child would know that it is a book before knowing it is a Filipino or English book. That's all. Thank you so much.
And that was the end of our discussion, but before ending this video, I would like to give the instructions regarding our assessment. So our assessment together with the handouts will be posted tomorrow, Friday, November 19, 2021. And you have 1 week to answer it. The deadline will be on next Friday, November 26, 2021. You can submit your answers to me through Facebook Messenger on or before the deadline. So that's it. I hope you learned something. Thank you so much for watching. Keep safe and God bless.
Hold up.